Headquartered in New York City, the throbbing heart of financial America. But Britain was overruled once again. America's leaders were determined to control the fund and insisted on its being based here in Washington, where it fell well within their sphere of influence. So Keynes's vision of a purely economic body gave way to something far more political, in which America would be calling the shots for years to come.
Keynes protested in vain.
The Americans have railroaded their plans through and invented a Frankenstein setup.
In April 1946, exhausted by the negotiations which had terribly strained his already weak heart, John Maynard Keynes died, aged just 62. It was perhaps fortunate that Keynes didn't live long enough to witness the impact on Britain of the loan agreements, terms and conditions. One of them threatened the seemingly impregnable Bank of England itself. In the loan agreement, Britain had been forced to make its currency fully and freely convertible with other currencies by as soon as 1947.
What was at stake here was nothing less than the credibility of Britain. Our standing as a great power had been symbolized by the strength of the mighty pound. And if the pound were to be humbled, a likely consequence of moving too quickly to sterling convertibility, then nothing would show more clearly how weak Britain had become and how mighty America and the triumphant dollar.
America the Bountiful wanted to sell goods to the world. It was determined to end the British Empire's domination of international trade. It was this dream that lay behind the demand for sterling convertibility. It would allow those selling goods to Britain to demand payment in dollars, not pounds sterling. They would then spend those dollars with American firms, leaving British businessmen without vital trade.
Well, I think that was lunacy. That was asking for complete catastrophe, and indeed, that's exactly what it caused. The British should have just turned around and said, that is impossible. We simply cannot do that. You will cause an overnight, economic disaster.
In July 1947, Britain's post-war economy started to break down under the pressure of sterling convertibility. The Bank of England held only a limited reserve of dollars, vital for obtaining supplies from America. Convertibility let foreign traders exchange sterling for dollars. Britain's reserves began to dwindle at an alarming rate.
Nobody wanted the British pound anymore. In just a few weeks, the Bank of England had paid out almost $1 billion in exchange for sterling. Now, in today's money, that's $11 billion and almost a quarter of the original American loan. If the dollar drain had continued like that, we would have exhausted our reserves by the end of the year, and we would have been bankrupt. Now, the terrible irony about all this is that the very thing that the American loan was supposed to have protected us against, a financial Dunkirk, was now upon us.
Attlee's government were once again contemplating national ruin. They had watched powerless as more than a quarter of the original loan hemorrhaged from the Bank of England.
The dollar drain must be stopped. Credit will be used up very rapidly, and for the purposes from which this country will derive little benefit. If this happens, we lay ourselves open to the accusation that we have allowed the loan to be frittered away.
the crisis it caused was enormous. The reserve, what was left of the reserves was being hoovered away by the minute. I mean, this made the ERM crisis was a bit of a small picnic compared with the 1947 crisis. That was a serious crisis. And in those days, it was more unusual. We're used to 24-hour, seven-day-a-week trading, vast amounts of money being traded on the foreign exchanges all day. Walls of money can suddenly move in a matter of hours from one place to another if you get it wrong. In 1947, that kind of thing didn't happen unless you had a truly calamitous event.
To avert national bankruptcy, sterling convertibility was suspended. The humiliation was intense and brought a whole new raft of austerity measures. Britain's press and public were outraged.
And we read these extraordinary headlines. Food imports cut by £12 million a month. Smaller army. Appeal to workers not to press wage claims. What in heaven's name is going on?
The humbling of a country that thought it had won the war. All of a sudden, it's just losing its own economic power. It's now becoming under the sway of the United States.
Less.
Very forceful, makes the point. And of course, meat cut to 1 shilling 5p. I mean, it's just incredible. But this must have really been humiliating for Britons. They fight the war alongside the Americans. The Americans pull the financial rug out from under their feet straight after the war. And what's the result? It's economic chaos. It's people being denied meat and basics.
And we have this incredible headline, Meatless Days.
In fact, I think there'd be riots on the streets now if all of a sudden the government decreed that there were going to be meatless days.
At the end of a very long 1947, it was left to new Chancellor Stafford Cripps to try and lift the country's spirits for Christmas.
I know this Christmas won't be a luxury one, and that you housewives are going to have a hard job making a Christmas show. But the spirit of Christmas and its family happiness will encourage us all. It's the cheerful facing of our difficulties that makes our country strong. I give you all Christmas thoughts and wishes, and I hope that 1948 will bring us nearer to the accomplishment of our purpose.
1948 did indeed bring with it a surprise cash present for Britain. Ironically, it was in part thanks to the threat of communism. Poland, Czechoslovakia, East Germany, Romania, Bulgaria had all fallen into Stalin's sphere of influence. America was developing a new foreign policy in response, containment. 1948 was the year of Marshall Aid, the brainchild of American Secretary of State, General George C. Marshall. Billion-dollar grants were offered to countries with ruined economies, like defeated Germany and victorious Britain.
They were afraid socialist ideas would spread. So if you could identify socialist ideas with the worst excesses of Stalin, you were home and dry. And the American ambassador to Britain spoke at the Speaker's House a few years ago, and he said the Marshall Plan was designed to defeat communism in Western Europe. That's what it was. He's absolutely blunt. I put it down in my diary.
General Marshall and his plan in the end provided the American solution with American money. There was an American interest in that. He persuaded Americans that they could not stand by and watch the Western European economy fall into chaos, that they just one day the Americans would benefit by having countries restored to ordinary prosperity with whom they could trade.
$13 billion were handed out as a free gift. The aim was to kickstart the economies of Western Europe and stop the spread of communism in the process.
I think most of us believed that it was absolutely essential to get America involved both militarily in the defense of Western Europe and economically in helping recovery through the Marshall Plan. And without American help after the war, I think the whole of Western Europe would have fallen to the Russians.
Britain received nearly $3 billion of Marshall Aid. It seemed like Keynes's plea for a free grant from America had finally been heard from beyond the grave, but only when it became part of a new American foreign policy. What a reminder that justice had been the wrong card for Keynes to play in America. So what are we meant to make of our relationship, special or otherwise, with the Americans? They bailed us out with the Marshall Plan, but then again, we have only just paid off our major multi-billion pound debt to them. Perhaps a clue can be found under the great dome of St. Paul's Cathedral, where those who have made a contribution to our national life are remembered.
St. Paul's Cathedral is as close as we get to a national shrine. Its very survival has come to symbolize our unflagging spirit during the Blitz. But the Germans did score a direct hit. Came through the roof up there, landed in the apse. But it failed to explode. A miracle, perhaps?
The bomb did destroy the high altar. So, after the war, there was an opportunity to dedicate a new sacred space right at the heart of our great cathedral.
A new chapel emerged from the wreckage, paid for by thousands of individual contributions from ordinary British men and women. It stands today as an expression of eternal gratitude to the United States of America. This is, and will for all eternity be, the American Memorial Chapel, paying tribute to the 28,000 American servicemen and women based in Britain who gave their lives in the Second World War. This is the book that lists those names. It moves me on a very personal level. Inscribed on this page are no less than 16 American servicemen called Mayor. So far as I know, I'm not related to any of them. But some 2,000 miles away from here lies the body of the father I never knew, Flight Lieutenant Reginald Henry Rome Mayer, killed in action in February 1944. And when all is said and done, isn't it this that matters most, that makes the relationship special? That tens of thousands of men and women from Britain and America sacrifice themselves in a common cause.
There's a new world over the skyline. To find it, follow the sun, where the skyline meets the sun.
The architect of this great building, Sir Christopher Wren, said that if you seek my monument, look around you. Its monument within, to American sacrifice in a common cause, underlines what our two countries can achieve together.
We in Britain must never forget that. But the 60-year-old story of the loan tells us something else as well. Never assume that sentiment will trump hard national interest. Never go into a negotiation without knowing where the other side will be coming from. And don't be afraid to talk tough when toughness is called for. In sum, don't expect more of the special relationship than it can deliver. That's not only in Britain's interests, it's in America's as well. And, quite possibly, the world's.
Imagine me with my...
The extraordinary rise and demise of the Attlee government, responsible for one of the most far-reaching reform programs we've ever known. The improbable Mr. Attlee. Next.
I'll buy that dream.
Was the Antichrist of anthropology.
Belligerent and rebellious, this man threw the rule book out.
Tom Harrison restarted headhunting in Borneo.
Some anthropologists would say he wasn't an anthropologist. I would say he was one of the best.
It was one of the most absurd job interviews.
He said, I'm getting divorced on Tuesday, getting married again on Thursday. Come and see me on Wednesday.
Cultural pioneer or enemy of the state? Meet the real Tom Harrison, the barefoot anthropologist in our anthropology season, coming soon on BBC4.